Good to see everybody this morning. Welcome to the first day of spring. Did you know today is the first day of spring? Super happy. Sounds like we may still have some winterish weather coming, but hey, we aren't going to worry about that. Stand with me if you would, and let's ask the Lord to bless our meeting time to get together today. Gracious God, Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus, we come humbly before your throne of grace. And we praise you, and we thank you, Lord, for your goodness. We thank you for this beautiful Sunday morning. Thank you for all of those that are here gathered together with the saints. I pray for those joining us online, those that are here in person. I'm praying that each and every person is just nourished and fed well on your word this morning. I pray that we just join our hearts and our mouths in praise to our King in song and in word. God, more than anything else, we're praying that Jesus is exalted and lifted up. And we just pray, Lord, for your presence and your power to move and work in our hearts and our lives the way that only you can. We love you. We praise you. We ask all this morning in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You're not welcome one another if you would. You won't get a bunch of reply texts, so it's not like you're going to be in a big chain email or text or any of that. You're just going to get one message sent to you letting you know whatever the announcement is. So that and our Facebook page are the only two ways that we communicate mass messaging. So if you're not on Facebook, you definitely want this one. If you are on Facebook, we do a lot of messaging through that, so you'll probably get most of the major messages. Enough of that. Grab one of those as you're on your way out. Wednesday night study. Come join us at 6:30 for our men's Bible study, our women's Bible study, and our middle school youth. They're going to be meeting as usual this Wednesday night. We'll all be meeting at 6:30. The last Wednesday night of this month, I think it's the 30th, we are going to do our fellowship dinner. So kind of put that on your calendars. That will also be at 6:30. Speaking of youth, next Sunday morning, right after the service, there's going to be a parent meeting. If you have a middle school youth, kiddo, or kid that's coming into middle school, Chad and Jennifer have got some dates and some information for you going into the summer. They want to meet with all the parents immediately following. It'll be a brief meeting. So we'll get you all out there. We'll get everybody else out of your way. We'll get you out there so you can have a meeting to get some information from them. And then as soon as that meeting is over, they're going to be taking the middle school youth kids to a baseball game. Remind me, where are you guys going?
Missouri State.
So they'll be going to the baseball game at Missouri State, doing some eating and fun and all that. So even if your kiddo is not going to the baseball game, please hang out for the meeting. You still need the information, but hopefully the kiddos can go to the game and have a good time there. So, what?
We're paying for the tickets, but they need those tickets.
So your ticket will be covered. So free ticket to the baseball game. All you'll need to bring is some money for eating or whatever, or, you know. All right. What else do I have here? Easter. So Easter is coming. By the way, if you're on our Facebook page, you probably noticed I had a tough moment this week. I've never made a mistake before. And this week I experienced that for the very first time. I had planned on having Convoy of Hope here this morning. We haven't had them in a couple years. We usually have them in about once a year, once every other year. So I had messaged the contact, Jeff Anderson, great guy, he's been here before. I had messaged him and I thought that we had scheduled this morning. And Friday I followed up with him. I said, hey, are you ready for Sunday morning? Anything I can do for you? Anything you need? And he immediately called me. And he said, I'm looking at your message right now. And it says, are you available April 20th? That's the day we agreed on. I meant March, but hey, I text April. So he wasn't available this morning, so here I am. So we'll be I'm going to be preaching from Luke today, and then starting next week, and that's where I was going with all this, starting next week we're going to go into a four-part series on Easter. So please be a part of that. Easter morning, we're going to do a breakfast. Starting next week, we're going to send around a sign-up sheet for everybody to sign up for whatever dish they can bring. Lori has all that organized. We'll get that out to you next week. But we hope that we can have a good crowd for Easter morning. We'll eat at 9 o'clock, get wrapped up, have service at 10 as usual, and that'll be the final message in this four-part series. So put all that on your calendar as well. Convoy of Hope is going to come, but we haven't scheduled that date yet. I've got to get with Jeff and reschedule an accurate date for that. There will be a Easter egg hunt for the kids. All the kids that are currently in Kids Church, we'll cut them loose, and we'll have an Easter egg hunt. Thank you for those that have brought eggs and candy and all that. If you still haven't brought any, bring them on in. We'll get them added. We can use all that you can bring. There is a women's ministry thingy-majigger coming up. It's out on the back table. We passed it around a couple of weeks now. We got a good sign-up. I think they're revealing their prayer sisters, and they're maybe signing up for other prayer sisters. Is that right, Stephanie? And they're doing this murder mystery luncheon thing, and that is going to be when? April 3rd. I'm really good with dates, so I got it. April 3rd, right after the service, April 3rd. So put that on your calendars. If you haven't signed up yet, she does need you to sign up as soon as possible. Because the way I understand it, she's got some stuff she's doing with those that sign up or something. It's going to be a fun time. It's going to be a great time next. Man, I hope that's all of them. Stand with me if you would. Let's prepare our hearts for worship. Gracious God, we love you so much, and it really is a privilege to be able to join our hearts in praise. And right now, the church will rejoice. We will exalt. We will praise you in spiritual songs and hymns and melody in our hearts to the Lord. So just bless and anoint our worship team right now as they lead us in this. Be glorified in every song. We ask this again in Jesus' name. Let's worship together. And the grace overwhelms.
Thank you. Oh.
a blessing to you. I also pray, Lord, that the words of those songs are a blessing to those that sung them this morning, particularly those that maybe are going through hardship or struggles or pain. Father, I pray that we know that one day we will rise. That is the blessed hope of the church. That one day this corruptible body will put on incorruption. We will be perfect and in your presence for all eternity. Lord, we look forward to that day. And Lord, may we hold fast to that truth when the waves are crashing in. We can say, it is all well. It is all well with my soul. It is good. Because I know he is my rock and my anchor. He's my fortress and my shield. In him do I trust. And because of these glorious truths, Lord, your church can join our hearts together this morning. We can sing. We exalt our Lord Jesus. We praise you. We thank you, God, for the promises that we have in your word. We stand on those promises this morning. But Lord, until those days come, until the blessed hope of the church is fulfilled, we need your help. We need your Holy Spirit, God. We cry out to you this morning. We pray for your help. We pray for your guidance. As we open up your word and we come to some hard stuff this morning, God, we know it's hard for us in the flesh, but in Christ, we can accomplish all things. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. We need your help this morning. Strengthen us until that glorious day comes. Strengthen us to live lives that honor and glorify you. Thank you, God, for this time of worship this morning. We want to continue to worship you in our giving and in the study of your word. Be lifted up once again. We ask this again in Jesus' name, and all God's people say, amen. God bless you. You can be seated. We're going to let our ushers come forward, give you the opportunity to worship the Lord in your giving. Enough of that for right now. We are on Luke 14. We're coming to Luke 15 after Easter. Listen up, Brandon. No, just kidding. Sorry. I might have said that too. Hey, Luke back chapter 14, verse 25. Luke 14, 25. I want to read through verse 35. Now great crowds accompanied Jesus, and he turned and he said to them, If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother, if he does not hate his wife and his children and his brothers and his sisters, yes, even hates his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, desiring to build a tower, does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, "This man began to build, and he was not able to finish." Or what king going out to encounter another king in war will not sit down and first deliberate whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? And if not, while the other is yet a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So therefore, any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is of no use either for the soil or for the manure pile. It's thrown away. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. You know, I've said this many times, when I was a young kid, I was terrible in school, terrible student, didn't put a lot of effort into school. I loved ag and football. Those are the two things I lived for. Outside of that, I couldn't care about any of them. I don't think I ever read a full book my whole school life. Never read a book. I started a couple books. When they did book studies, they tell us you guys got to read a book, do a report. I never did that. I found somebody to cheat off of just enough. If I could get a D minus, I was good. I graduated on D minuses. There were 32 kids in my graduating class, and I was number 22. I didn't have a problem with that for years. I thought, there's 10 kids bigger than me. So I was okay. Over the years, I'm thankful. I am thankful. God has given me a desire to learn, and really, he's given me a desire to read. I now love to read. I wish I would have loved to read back then. I read a lot of books. I still try to read as much as I can. Sometimes I feel guilty, but I don't feel like I'm getting in enough reading time. Not just the Word, primarily the Word, but also other books. There have been some books that I've read as an adult, and particularly as I've gotten into ministry, there have been a few books, I'd say maybe 4 or 5, that have really radically impacted how I read the Word. They've helped me understand the Bible or certain theological points of the Bible that I've really held on to. It's become a big part of my preaching. One of those books that was written several years ago was by a pastor named John MacArthur. I think I've got his picture up here. That's John MacArthur. He pastors Grace Church out in California. He has for about 40 years now. He's been at that church. He has wrote tons and tons of books. He has an entire New Testament commentary for every New Testament book. I would encourage you to read anything and everything you can get your hands on from John MacArthur. Although I do not agree with every theological point he shares, he is probably one of the greatest Bible expositors I've ever encountered. He wrote a book back in 1988, and I didn't read it back then. It was several years later before I read it, but it was called The Gospel According to Jesus. He came under a lot of fire when he wrote this book because at that time, MacArthur was one of the few evangelical pastors in the Reformed movement that preached what has now become known as Lordship Salvation. A lot of people still don't like Lordship Salvation, and you'll probably figure out why in just a moment. The doctrine of Lordship Salvation teaches that submitting to Christ as Lord goes hand in hand with trusting Him as Savior. You've probably heard that old line, some people want a Savior, but they don't want a Lord. MacArthur kind of made that popular. That's the whole idea of Lordship Salvation. You can't have one without the other. They both come in a package deal. Matter of fact, MacArthur summarizes Lordship Salvation in this book with this, and I quote, "The gospel call to faith presupposes that sinners must repent of their sin and yield to Christ's authority. In other words, a sinner who refuses to repent is not saved, for he cannot cling to his sin and the Savior at the same time. And a sinner who rejects Christ's authority in his life does not have saving faith, for true faith encompasses a surrender to God. Thus, the gospel requires more than making an intellectual decision or mouthing a prayer. The gospel message is a call to discipleship, The sheep will follow their shepherd in submissive obedience. End quote. I want you to know this morning that your pastor, this humble, handsome fellow that stands before you today, I may not agree with John MacArthur on all points, but I do stand with him on this one. As a matter of fact, Lordship salvation is one of the distinctives of our church. And that's a whole other study that we've done in years past, and I want to come back to at some point in the near future. Today's text is one of many that I would, and that MacArthur would point you to help you better understand this idea of Lordship salvation. And a lot of people in the church today have trouble with this idea of Lordship salvation, and they even struggle with this passage we just read, because it really strikes at the heart of what has also become known as easy believism. I've said it many times, and I'll keep saying it, and you'll hear me say it over and over. Anybody that looks you in the eye and says, it's easy to be a Christian, are not living the Christian life. Because it's not easy. It costs us. It is tough at times. But before jumping into the text, MacArthur brings up a very important word, and it's in our text this morning. It's the word disciple. It's so important that we understand what we're talking about when we use this word disciple. And the reason that I want to spend a few minutes here is that there's a lot of controversy around particularly this text among Christians and theologians, and it's led a lot of people, primarily here in the West, people in other parts of the world don't really struggle with this as much, but some here in our American culture have come right out and they said that when you read passages like this, when Jesus is saying, if you want to be a disciple, you must fill in the blank. When you read that, don't hear salvation. Jesus isn't talking about salvation here. He's not saying that salvation will cost you anything. Only discipleship will cost you. So folks that hold to this theory separate being saved and being a disciple. They would argue that anybody who hears the gospel, believes it, and confesses their sin, they're saved. Some people out of that group will go on to be a disciple of Christ. I want to quickly show you this morning there's no biblical warrant for that thinking at all. Matter of fact, the scripture tells us just the opposite. Acts chapter 6, verse 1. It says, in these days when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. So the 12 summoned the full number of the disciples and said, it's not right that we should be given up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Folks, when Luke, the author of our text here this morning, is using that word disciples over here in the book of Acts, is he talking about only the level 2 Christians? The problem was only with them. It wasn't with the level 1 Christians. It was just the level 2 Christians. Did they only summon the level 2 Christians? No. When he uses the word disciples, he means everybody in the body. All believers. You go on to verse 7. The word of God continued to increase, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. So, were only level 2 people multiplying? Or was it all believers began to multiply? It's all believers. Acts chapter 11. When Barnabas had found Saul, he brought him to Antioch, and for a whole year they met with the church, and they taught a great many people, and in Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians. Is that only level 2 people earned the title of Christian? No. We could go on and on and on this morning, but I want to be crystal clear about something. To be a Christian is to be saved. It is to be a disciple. All these things are synonymous. There is no such thing as I'm saved and I'm not a disciple yet. Yes, you are. If you're born again, if you've truly been born again, if you've been saved by the blood of Jesus, you are a disciple of Christ. So everything the scripture says about disciples applies to you. All right. So we've laid that groundwork. Let's examine today's text. If you go back to verse 25, it opens up with Luke telling us that there were great crowds accompanying Jesus, and they were following basically everywhere he went. It seemed like Jesus had huge crowds. And here's what dawned on me this week, and I've never really thought about it till this week as I was putting this together. This crowd of people was following Jesus, and Jesus literally stops. He turns around and he tells them how to follow him. Think about that for a moment. They're already following, and yet Jesus turns around and says, if you're going to follow me, here's what it's going to take. And I was reminded of a very important truth this week. There is a way to follow Jesus, and then there's following Jesus. It's very similar with, there's a way to know Jesus, and then there's a way to know Jesus. There is an external, maybe legalistic, formal way of following or knowing Christ. But let's not forget, Jesus said there will be some who will stand before him on that day and will say, Lord, we did this, we did that. You remember what Jesus said? I didn't know you. So there's knowing Jesus, and then there's knowing Jesus. There's following Jesus, and then there's following Jesus. Jesus turns to this crowd who is already following him, and he says something. And this is where a lot of the controversy comes up. Jesus turns to him in verse 26. He says, if you are going to be an actual follower, in other words, if you're going to move beyond just being the crowd that follows me around, if you're going to be a real follower, if you're going to be a disciple, well, you're going to have to hate your own father. You're going to have to hate your mother, your wife, your children, your brothers, your sisters. Yeah, you're going to have to hate even your own life. Now, what in the world do we do with that? That sounds tough. Why would Jesus ever tell us to hate anybody, anywhere, at any time? I mean, let's be clear. This is the same God, Jesus, in Matthew 5. You've heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy? No! Love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you. Jesus also says in John 13, by this all people will know that you're my disciples if you love one another. Maybe we have uncovered a great contradiction in the Bible. Maybe we can point to this and say, aha! This is why the Bible can't be trusted. Jesus tells us over here to love, 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 love. And then he comes over here and he tells us to hate, 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 hate. Gotta be a contradiction. Not at all. Matter of fact, if you're there in your Bible in Luke chapter 14, I would encourage you to write a Bible passage off to the side of your Bible somewhere. In the margins. And the passage is Matthew chapter 10, verse 37. This passage provides us with the interpretive key to understanding this dilemma that we come across over here in Luke. Jesus is speaking. He says, whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. This is the same point he's trying to get across over in Luke's gospel. Jesus wants the crowd to know, and this is for us too. He wants us to know that to follow Jesus, to be a disciple of Christ, is going to require a reset on your priorities. I know some of you have been with me a long time. Some of you have even been to wedding ceremonies that I've done. Did one yesterday, right here at the church. In every ceremony, there are certain passages that I read. Matter of fact, I tell couples right up front, I won't do your wedding for you unless I include these verses. So far, everybody say, yeah. One of the passages that I always include about marriage is found in Genesis 2:24. It says, therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold them fast to his wife, and they will become one flesh. When God created the first marriage relationship, it required a reset of priorities. What does it say about the man? He has to leave his father and mother. Now, the relationship that he's entering into supersedes all other relationships. Now, his wife is a bigger priority than his mother or his father or any of the other family he came from. Same applies to the lady. Your primary responsibility now is to your spouse above all else, or at least in that context. The Apostle Paul comes along in Ephesians chapter 5, another passage I always read at every wedding, and he says, we are members of his body. And then he quotes from Genesis. He says, therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother, hold fast to his wife, the two will become one flesh. And then Paul adds this in verse 32. This mystery is profound. And I'm saying that it refers to Christ and the church. Paul's saying that God gave us marriage. He created it in the garden. He gave it to us. He designed it. And in that design, God says that when a man and a woman enter into the covenant of marriage, there's a reset in the marriage priorities, and it's the same with your faith. When you enter into covenant relationship with Christ, When you become joined to the bridegroom and you become part of the bride of Christ, your priorities must go through a reset. He must come first above everything. Mother, father, son, daughter, brother, sister. He's got to be primary. He demands that of us. You can't be a disciple if it's not that way. He goes on to verse 27. He says something that's equally hard, but maybe we miss it a little bit. Verse 27, he says, "Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple." You know, I commented a couple weeks ago on a picture Tom sent out. Tom took a beautiful picture, I assume, with his phone, and Tom's got a big lighted cross. How big is that thing, Tom? 30 feet high or something? It's big. Big old cross out there on his property. He took a picture of that, and it had the sun coming up behind it, and there was some clouds. It is a beautiful picture. It ought to be in a frame. And he sent that out to all the fellows. I believe it was the morning before our Bible study, maybe, or maybe the day before. I can't remember. But either way, I remember thinking about that picture, thinking how beautiful it was. And then I thought, that picture would not have been as pretty and as beautiful back in our Lord's day. Matter of fact, nobody in their right mind would have even taken a picture like that. Nobody would have even considered the cross to be anything pretty, even if the sun was coming up behind a wooden cross. Crosses were ugly. They were terrible. They were symbols of death, and not just death, torturous death. I read just recently where the Romans, in the first century Rome, they used to ride into villages looking for an individual. They find the individual, the criminal, whoever they're looking for, and they would drag that person out of their house, and they would walk, and they would escort him to the place of execution. And you know what they often would do? They would make him put a huge wooden cross on his shoulder and drag his cross to the place of execution. This was a common thing. Jesus wasn't the only one to ever carry a wooden cross to execution. The Romans made people do this all the time. Imagine being a mother watching her son drag a wooden cross out of the house off to be executed. Imagine if you were a son watching your dad go off to execution. Imagine if that was your spouse or whoever. What if that was one of your children? You wouldn't take a picture of that cross. It wouldn't be a pretty thing. The cross was a symbol of horrible, horrible torture, pain, suffering, and death. So with that in mind, we come back to our Lord's words here. And he turns around and says, if you're going to be a disciple, you can't be a disciple of mine unless you're willing to bear your own cross right to death. Don't think you can be a disciple if you're not willing to do that. Some have questioned what exactly did Jesus mean there. Is he talking about salvation? Well, I think it could be applied that way. Matter of fact, that's what happens at salvation. We die with Christ. We hear the message of the cross, the gospel. We believe that by faith. Jesus says in John chapter 12, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." So I think you could apply this to the salvation experience, but I don't believe that's what Jesus is speaking to here. And the reason I say that is back several chapters ago, or a few chapters ago, several weeks ago for us, Luke chapter 9, Jesus says, if anyone wants to follow me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily. Jesus isn't telling us to be saved daily. That's a one-time event. So what does he mean when he says, take up this cross daily and follow after me? If you're going to be a disciple of mine, Jesus said, you better be willing to put that cross on your shoulder daily. Jesus isn't telling us to be saved daily. He's telling us that saved people die daily. Saved people crucify the flesh daily. I'm going to guess you guys are similar to me. I've been saved a lot of years now. I've been in ministry and I love the Lord and I've grown. But you know what? There's still old sinful residue in my flesh. There's still days where I struggle with old fleshly desires. I got to crucify those. I got to die to that stuff. I got to kill it. I got to ask God for the grace and the strength to do that. I think this is what Paul meant in 1 Corinthians 15 when he says, I protest, brothers, by my pride in you, which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord. He says, I die daily, Paul says. Daily I die. Well, we know that wasn't literal physical death. And he doesn't mean that he's getting saved every day. He's saying, every day I'm crucifying the flesh. Every day in Christ Jesus, I'm killing those old fleshly desires. To be a disciple requires daily crucifixion of the flesh. And Jesus says again, I'm willing to do that. Can't follow me. Verse 28 to 32, Jesus drives his points home with two illustrations. He talks about a builder and a king, both of them going out to war. And in both of these illustrations, Jesus is making the point. He's saying, hey, listen, nobody starts to build a tower unless they sit down first and count it up. All right, how much is this tower? You don't want to be a laughing stock in the community, but you got half the tower built and you ran out of money. Same thing with a king going out to war. King's not going to take on an army of 20,000 if he only has 10,000 troops. He's going to sit down and he's going to count the cost. That's the point Jesus is making. You better count the cost here. Now, as I thought about that, and have thought about that passage many times over the years, I've often wondered, how does that play out for us? Am I wrong on Sunday mornings to ask people, who wants to give their heart to Jesus? Let me pray with you. Should we maybe not do that? Should we maybe instead say, if you're interested, if you feel the Lord tugging at your heart, there's a class, and in this class you need to be educated as to what the cost is going to be. We need to let you know right up front what you're signing up for. In other words, you need to read the fine print of the agreement before you check, I agree. The Puritans used to do that, by the way. Years ago, I got into the Puritan letters, and the early Puritan church, they never asked for salvation. They would always say, if you feel the Holy Spirit tugging on your heart, that's wonderful. We'll pray with you. We'll pray that you'll be saved. And then they always gave it a period of time. And they felt like that period of time, they wanted to see how you dealt with persecution, how you dealt with heartache, how you dealt with temptation. And if you didn't deal with those things very well, they would consider you unsaved. Don't know that I agree with that either. And I don't think we're wrong in doing it the way we're doing it, but I will tell you where I do think we're wrong sometimes. I think the church, primarily here in the West, in America, I don't think we need to set people down and say, hey, before you acknowledge Jesus as Lord and Savior, here's a list of things you better be ready for. But I do think after people make this decision, after people feel the tug on their heart, after people acknowledge the gospel and believe it by faith, I think the church must be engaged in training the fellowship in what it means to live a life that honors and glorifies God. And I think the church has got to put to death this easy believism. And we've got to put to death this prosperity gospel stuff. We've got to quit sending a message that if you'll just give your heart to Jesus, man, your whole life will be better. That's what Jesus ever said. Jesus said, you follow me, you're going to be persecuted. You're going to be thrown in prison. You're going to be hated. They're going to hate you because they hated me. I wish there were no break there in verse 34 and 35. My Bible, there's a little title. It says, salt without taste is worthless. I wish it wasn't there because verse 34 just flows right out of what we just read in verse 33. Jesus uses this metaphor that he uses often. He uses the metaphor of salt. And he says, salt is good. I love salt, by the way. I eat way too much of it. But he says, if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? We know back in these days, salt was used for flavoring food. It was also a powerful preservative. They didn't have any refrigeration, couldn't freeze stuff, so they often rubbed salt in the meat and they would preserve the meat. The metaphor is pretty easy and straightforward, I think. If salt quits acting as salt, what do we do with it? Throw it out. Jesus said you can throw it out, trample it underfoot. You can throw it out on the manure pile. That's all it's worth. That's all it's worth if it's not going to be salty. Now, how in the world does this tie into what we just read about being a disciple? Jesus is saying, only those who are willing to love and serve God above all else are truly disciples of Christ. Those who are not willing to do this are no good to the kingdom. They have no influence in this dark world. And therefore, They're no good to him at all. They are salt without saltiness. And they will be cast out. Folks, it is not, at no point anywhere in the New Testament scriptures are we told that it's easy to be a follower of Christ. It ain't easy being a disciple. It's simply not. It's going to require some stuff of you. We're not talking about earning salvation here. That's not it at all. But I am telling you, those who say, "Jesus, I'll follow you," better be ready. Because a life following Christ is going to cost you something. And if it's not costing you anything at all, you got to question whether you're really following Christ. I'll tell you who doesn't struggle with this. You know who doesn't question these kinds of texts at all? People in Africa don't question this. The church in Africa, the church in China, the church in North Korea, these people who, they're living this. They know. They know right up front. If I join this little group of people over here called Christians, if I believe in Jesus as my Savior, my family's going to abandon me. The authorities are going to come get me. They're either going to kill me or they're going to throw me in prison. They're going to take all my possessions. I'm going to lose everything. They don't have to sit around and scratch their heads and say, "I wonder what Jesus really meant by that." They never have that conversation because they're living it every day. We here in the West, we struggle. And you come to verse 33, it's got to be one of the sternest warnings for the church. Jesus says, "Therefore," in other words, based on everything I've just said, I want you to know this, "Therefore, if any one of you who does not, any one of you who does not renounce all that he has, cannot be a disciple." I do not at all believe that Jesus is saying, go sell everything you own and just kind of walk around preaching the gospel, hoping somebody feeds you and takes care of you. He's not telling us that. It comes back to that priority thing. Jesus is saying, there's a reset on your priorities. I got to be supreme in your heart. I got to be above all. Today's text has to serve as a powerful wake-up call to the church here in the West. We have got to confess and repent of our worldly, easy believism. We must prioritize our relationship with Christ above all other relationships, to include our spouse, our children, our grandchildren, our friends. We got to pray without ceasing, asking God to grant us the grace to crucify our flesh and all those old worldly desires that wage war against our spirit. We got to pray and ask God for the grace and the strength to walk humbly before him in obedience to his word. We got to rely on the Spirit's help to be the salt of this world, preserving truth and exposing evil. If you're here this morning and you call yourself a disciple of Jesus, I just described what you signed up for. That's what it is. Jesus says, you can't do that. Just hang out with the crowd. He also tells us, if you choose to be a disciple of mine, it's going to cost you. Oh, but the reward is going to be great. It may cost you in this life, but there's so much more than this life. And if this is too much for you, then Jesus says, well, that's going to cost you too. The rewards for that decision? Hell. Literally hell. I praise God that he's provided a way of escape from that. And I want us to thank you for that right now. Gracious God, I know this morning we come to a passage of your word that is hard for many of us to hear and to grasp, especially when we preach so much and we teach so much on the glory of grace. We preach so much on not earning salvation. And Lord, I pray that nobody here this morning is hearing a message that we somehow have to check all the boxes before we can be born again. But Lord, once again, I'm reminded of the glorious balance of the gospel. On the one hand, we are saved by grace through faith, and that is all alone. That is nothing more. But on the other hand, a person who is saved by grace through faith is then called to live out what you've called them to be, and that is holy. You've called us to be disciples, to learn and grow. And Lord, may we all know this morning that some of us are further down that discipleship road than others. It's not going to happen overnight. It is a journey. It's a life lived out by faith. And along that road, we're going to struggle. We're going to sin against you. We're going to fail at times. Father, that doesn't mean we stop being disciples. It just means that we come to understand and appreciate your grace so much more. But Lord, I do pray for your church today. I pray for any here that are listening online, or maybe this is the first time they've heard this preaching. Maybe they're not familiar with lordship salvation. Maybe they made a decision to follow you simply because they don't want to go to hell. Lord, it's so much more than that. May you reveal that to them this morning. May they know that the Christian life is not just fire insurance. God, it's a relationship. It's walking with you daily. It's talking to you daily. It's growing in your word. It's hearing you speak into our heart and into our life. May we be true disciples of Jesus. And Lord, for those here this morning that maybe have realized they're not a disciple of Christ at all. Maybe, perhaps they even said a prayer sometime many, many years ago, but this morning your Holy Spirit's knocking on the door of their heart saying, you've never truly been born again. You've never truly followed me as a disciple. You've still put so many other things ahead of me. Father, I pray that there'd be a reset this morning. I pray that you'd come into their heart and their life powerfully. Lord, that you'd reset their priorities, that you'd turn their heart, their gaze from the things of this world to the things of God. May they set their eyes on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father. May you pour out your great and powerful grace on them. So our heads are bowed. I do want to ask that question again today. Is there anybody that would acknowledge and say, Steve, I think you just described me to the T. Maybe you said a prayer of salvation at some point, but you believe, you know in your heart, you're not a true disciple of Christ. Or maybe you've never even confessed that before. Either way, you know today in your heart that you are not following Christ. You're not a true disciple. That can change right now, here today. That can change. You can be reborn, your priorities reset. If that's you this morning, I do want to pray with you. As you pray, I want to pray with you. Is there anybody who quickly slip their hand up and say, Steve, you just described me. I know that's me. I want to know who you are. Anyone? Praise God. Stand with me if you would then. Well, gracious and holy God, your word is good, and I thank you so much for it. I thank you, Lord, it truly is a lamp to our feet, a light to our path. And as we leave here today, I pray that these words will guide us, direct us. I pray, Lord, they'll convict us. I pray, Lord, that your word will encourage us, strengthen us to be the church, the body of Christ, the salt that you've called us to be in this world. Lord, this dark, dark world needs salt and needs light. And we are that salt and that light. Empower us to go out of here today and fulfill that calling. May we fulfill your great, glorious commission. Love you. I thank you again for the opportunity to worship together with my family today. Pray you bless each and every one of them until we can come back together Wednesday night and open up your word and pray again together. And Lord, just be glorified once again in all that we do and say. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, folks. Have a wonderful afternoon.